Warning, this experiment deals with extremely high temperatures, flammable materials, and molten metal. This should be performed outside with appropriate fire safety precautions. Greetings, fellow nerds! In a previous video, I showed various ways for making iron oxides for use in thermite. In this video, we're going to make thermite and test all the iron oxides we created. So here we have various sources of iron oxides. Starting from the left, we have rust that was made from steel wool. We have wet chemical iron oxide that was made from a solution of iron chloride salts. And we have electrolytic iron oxide that was made by electrolysis of iron nails in a saltwater solution. For comparison purposes, I've also included pottery-grade iron oxide that can be easily bought online as a pigment for pottery use. And I have laboratory-grade iron oxide, which is extremely pure and used for scientific research. All these samples have a mass of 60 grams, except for the rust, which has a mass of 30 grams. I have less rust because I didn't make enough. Anyway, let's get started. Now, in order to make iron oxide and aluminum thermite, you need to use 1 gram of aluminum for every 3 grams of iron 3 oxide. You don't need to be extremely precise, as thermite is somewhat forgiving of the ratio. Since I have 30 grams of iron oxide rust here, I'll be using 10 grams of aluminum powder. Let me mix that up. Now we'll need a container. Obviously, a glass beaker will shatter at the extreme heat of the reaction. So we'll use this clay flower pot, which has a convenient drainage hole that will drain the molten iron through. Now we can't have the thermite mixture draining before the reaction even starts, so we put in some aluminum foil to block the hole. Molten iron will then melt through the aluminum foil and drain out. Okay, we're ready. Obviously, I'm not going to light this in my fume hood as it will melt right through. So we're going to do this outside in a highly sophisticated thermite testing rig. And here is our highly sophisticated thermite testing rig. Now, to ignite the thermite, I'm going to use some sparklers that I've wrapped in magnesium ribbon. I find this method more reliable than either sparklers or magnesium ribbon alone. Just insert the magnesium wrapped end into the thermite and light the other end with a torch. And there it goes. Only 40 grams total of thermite, and it was hot enough to crack the flower pot. Let me get in closer. You can see some of the red-hot globules of molten iron. The rest of the iron has drained through the hole. We'll let that cool and examine it later. Here we are a couple of hours later. You can see here 3 shiny globules of solidified iron metal. And on the brick, we have the rest of the iron. Now most of this is actually a slag of aluminum oxide, so we'll have to smash out the iron with a hammer and chisel. A lot of people mistaken the red-hot molten liquid as pure iron when they're actually looking at the slag. Okay, there we go, and there is our nugget of iron. We can test it by holding a magnet near it. Iron has a very strong attraction to a magnet. The aluminum oxide slag might have a small attraction from tiny amounts of residual iron, but this is very weak. Alright, let's move on to our next test. Wet chemical iron oxide. Now originally this came in large chunks, so I smashed it into smaller pieces with a hammer. It's very important to use as small particle size as possible, as the more surface area you have, the faster and smoother the reaction. While it is possible to use larger chunks, it's extremely difficult to ignite, and you usually have to start out with a small batch of fine particle thermite to get it going. Okay, since I have 60 grams of iron oxide, I'll use 20 grams of aluminum this time. Here we are, and I've already placed and lit the magnesium-wrapped sparklers. Chemically, what's happening is the iron oxide is reacting with aluminum metal to produce iron metal and aluminum oxide. In this case, the aluminum is the fuel that accepts oxygen, and the iron oxide is the oxidizer that provides oxygen. Ideally, the reaction produces no gases, so it can't lose heat that way. All the heat stays in the products, and thus it can become extremely hot. Aluminum is an extremely energy-rich fuel, so its oxidation generates a lot of heat. Combined, these two properties allow thermite to easily reach molten iron temperatures. It looks like our reaction is completed. We've got a very nice formation of molten aluminum oxide and iron. All our material is drained through, so let's wait for this to cool down before recovering the iron. Here we are. Looks like it once again destroyed the flower pot. Let me see if I can break it off. Ooh, there we go. Yeah, looks like I'll have to use the hammer and chisel again to separate the iron and slag. Okay, let me start work on it. The iron, being much denser than the aluminum oxide slag, sinks to the bottom while the slag floats on top. This is actually very useful in the metal industry because the floating slag actually protects the molten iron from being reoxidized by the air. And here we go! We've recovered several nuggets of iron from the wet chemical iron oxide. They're separate nuggets rather than one big nugget because the thermite wasn't hot enough for long enough to have them coalesce. We also need a better receiving container than this brick, but oh well. Let's move on. Now we're going to try electrolytic iron oxide. Here we are, 60 grams of iron oxide mixed with 20 grams of aluminum powder and lit with a magnesium wrapped sparkler. Aluminum is the fuel of choice for thermite as it produces a lot of heat energy when it reacts with oxygen and it boils at a very high temperature of around 2500 degrees Celsius. By having a high boiling point, it can reach high temperature without boiling away and being lost. Magnesium metal is also very energetic as a fuel, but has a boiling point of around 1000 degrees Celsius, so it can't reach a higher temperature without being lost to boiling. Okay, looks like we're done. We have a nice complete reaction with most of the mixture drained out. And there is our pool of iron and slag. Once again, we'll wait for it to cool and recover iron. And here we are, let's see what we got. If you're just after molten iron and less interested in high temperatures, then you can spike your thermite mixture with bits of raw iron like nails. Some of the heat energy will go into melting the raw iron, so you'll get more molten iron at a somewhat lower temperature. Be careful of adding too much iron though, or else it won't melt. Anyway, here's our recovered iron. These nuggets appear to be larger and better formed than the impure wet chemical iron oxide I was using. Okay, let's move on and try pottery grade iron oxide. This is probably the easiest type of iron oxide to buy. And there it goes. Now thermite is not restricted to just iron oxide and aluminum. You can also use other metal oxides like copper oxide or chromium oxide and obtain copper and chromium respectively. But be careful, those compositions may burn at faster rates and copper oxide thermites in particular burn with an almost explosive speed. I don't recommend testing alternative thermites without thorough research beforehand. Okay, looks like we're done. It performs just as well as our other iron oxides. Alright, let's let that cool and hack out our iron. When making thermite, it's important to have dry powders. So it helps to heat them up first to drive off any water. If they're not dry, then as the thermite reacts, the absorbed moisture quickly converts to steam and can blow apart the thermite, sending bits of molten metal all around. That's why I have a crude contained testing rig to direct any flying metal away from nearby things I want to protect. Fortunately, all my thermite was well behaved. Okay, here we are, nice big nuggets of iron. As you can see, the pottery grade iron oxide is pretty good, so I don't recommend making your own iron oxide if you can easily buy pottery grade iron oxide. Now let's try laboratory grade iron oxide. I'm using two flower pots to contain the greater heat I'm expecting. And there it goes. Now in addition to sparklers and magnesium ribbon, thermite can also be ignited with a mixture of potassium chloride and sugar, better known as rocket candy. I'm told that potassium permanganate and glycerin also works, but I never tried that one myself to know. In any case, I still prefer sparklers and magnesium ribbon for their reliability. Okay, looks like this thermite worked very well. Interesting, it didn't fully react. I don't think it's because of lower quality, actually I think the opposite happened. The reaction was so fast that it melted through the aluminum foil and drained out before it could spread to the rest of the mixture. Nonetheless, most of it reacted. Let's wait for this to cool and recover the iron. And here we are. We can see a small amount of unreacted thermite. Despite being an incomplete reaction and having two flower pots, the laboratory grade iron oxide was still high enough to crack them both. I don't have enough laboratory grade iron oxide to try again, but if I did, I would keep the reaction going longer by using an iron sheet to plug the hole in the flower pot rather than aluminum foil. The iron would take longer to melt, and hopefully the reaction would spread throughout the mixture before draining away. Wow, look at that! At least the laboratory grade thermite was hot enough and pure enough to coalesce into one solid piece of iron. I think I'm going to keep this as a souvenir. Anyway, there you have it, testing various sorts of iron oxide for thermite. They all work reasonably well, so use whatever iron oxide is easiest or cheapest for you to obtain. Thanks for watching!
If you would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, please support the channel on Patreon. Links are in the video description.
I've gotten a lot of requests for this, so in this video we're going to make iron oxide for use in the famous thermite reaction.